Orleans was fun. It was... It just was a couple nights on Bourbon Street, and it really kicked my ass. And, I mean, the people there were great, and the energy was great. But it's just one of those things that I just wouldn't do again. Unless I might, like, build the energy to go, like, to Mardi Gras or something, but...
It's like Vegas. You leave and you're like, oh man, I don't know if I could ever do that again. And then, you know, next year comes around.
And then you're a little bit more open to it.
Yeah.
Why not?
It was dirty. I do remember that.
New Orleans is like an armpit.
Especially Bourbon Street too.
Yeah. Well, I just remember the first night, like when I got in Friday evening, I walked around along Bourbon Street just to see what it was like. And I kind of got it from a sober point of view versus, like, you know, really, really drunk, which were the
majority of the time.
Yeah. And I just remember walking down Bourbon Street, just, you know, relatively sober. And I just looked at the street and I could not believe how much trash was around. But the crazy thing is the next morning when we walk around French Quarters and we're looking for breakfast spots, I mean, you got to pay those street cleaners triple what a typical street clean
is. It clean the next day?
Yeah, it's relatively clean despite the piss smell. But and then we went on a swamp tour and that was really fun.
You see some mean gators while you're on that trip?
Yeah, saw a few gators. The smaller gators hang out with one another, but then the 13 footers just kind of control their territory. Is pretty
dude, crazy. Screw that shit. My mom was telling me a story of down in Florida. There was a gate at Orlando Studios or whatever it is down there, Universal Studios. And she was telling me there was a story about how some parents just looked the other way and their toddler was hanging out by the water, just got chomped by a gator and taken alive. And like, it was gone forever. It died. And I'm just like, you gotta be like, I don't mess with those things, man. Like, any gators, I'm not going near. And she told me that story. I'm like, all right. If you're parents and you're down in Florida, mm-hmm. where that's gator country, I mean, what are you doing leaving your kid by a pond? Like, god damn. That's terrible, brutal, brutal shit.
Eaten by a reptile, man. That's a bad way to go.
Yeah, they were here first a long time ago.
Yeah, they were.
Dinosaurs, man. Dinosaurs.
But they overall, it was a lot of fun. Paul Sheldon and I had a good time. Claire Fritz, Brian McFall.
I didn't want to be the one to have to say this, but you know, we got three other guys on the show. How's this shirt I'm wearing not been commented on how cool it is?
I love it.
Yes. I actually did.
It's the first time I looked at it.
Yeah.
It's tight, isn't it? Ken Griffey Jr., baby.
The listeners, he's wearing a Griffey shirt and it's got the gold chain. It's got the massive bubble gum.
Backwards hat too.
Backwards cap, eye black, the earring.
Ty France was wearing this the post game after his first walk off as Mariner this season.
Oh yeah,
and I saw it. It's by Baseballism. They make these shirts. He was wearing another shirt that had you can't spell Haniger without HR Homer. So this company just makes dope shirts, and I saw Ty France wearing it, and I bought it. I had to pre-order it that day, so I pre-ordered this 2 months ago.
That's not the dope of a shirt, dude. HR,
it's yeah,
letters,
yeah, can't spell Haniger without HR. I know I touched on this. I was originally going to have this out last Monday. Is the GoFundMe for Oscar's Army? But Evan, our producer, our Emmy-nominated producer, he put together quite a video, and the final touches have been updated, and we're going to be releasing this later here today or tomorrow, whatever. I guess I get that sent to me, Evan. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But it's a full-on video, promotional video for this. For the Oscars Army GoFundMe. Again, what we're hoping to do is get $9,000 to get 100 Oscars into T-Mobile Park on July 26th when Houston comes back to T-Mobile Park, and we give it to them. And so very excited about that. Oscars Army's promotional video GoFundMe is coming out today.
Hey, Mariner fans, we're doing a little bit of a late intro here just because we like to change things up. As Chris Soba says, you know how we do. You know how we do.
I don't know if I've ever said it exactly, dude, like that.
Oh my
God. You've never heard him say that.
I so have heard him say that. But my name is Max Schwabi. I'm here with Chris Soba and Chris Weifel and Evan Barron. And we're here to rock your ears with whatever the hell just happened with the Mariners this week. What are we excited about? Did anyone, obviously we're recording this on a Sunday. Chris, I'll leave that to you, but Anyone else get nervous watching the ninth inning? The bottom
no, half of the ninth. No, because we have such, because we have such a cushion. And, right. And put, I mean, Keenan, they're saying, because Keenan Milton obviously came in, but he had warmed up earlier, and then like he went to sit down. Yeah. And so Mike Bowers was saying something about how it could be potentially, you know, like messing with him, with his mind, getting it all set, but then having to turn it off, then turn it back on. Right. But I mean, yeah, whatever. His first bad outing with a lot of cushion, and then we were able to bounce back real quick with Steckenrider coming in, and good to have him back. Kendall Graveman is throwing a game tomorrow, I believe, in Tacoma, a rehab assignment. And I don't really know why he's coming off I don't know why he's on a rehab assignment when he just had COVID. No other guys have gone down for a rehab assignment. Do you guys know anything about that?
Not a clue. I didn't know
that. Yeah, I guess get him back acclimated with a little bit easier competition. But yeah, I mean, we haven't dealt with a COVID injury, so we don't even know what it would look like if a guy comes back after that.
So he had to have had COVID then, if it's an injury, like, right? He must have like actually been sick.
Someone in that group who all went to the IL did, and then the other three that were around them were placed on IL for being around him. So I don't know if they released who had COVID or if it was
it probably was Kendall, because he's the one still like on the list. Like,
well, so
probably feared it too.
And actually, this weekend when I was at this bachelor party, one of my buddies, I had no clue, he works with Scott's son. Scott Service's son, and I was curious on like if he said anything about COVID, and he's like, Scott's freaking pissed about, like, it's not the fact that like these guys aren't getting vaxxed, it's the fact that they're completely anti-vax. So we got a lot of anti-vaxxers on our Seattle Mariners team. Like, to whatever, like, do what you want. It's a free world, free country. I'm not gonna tell anybody how to act. You know, do
this isn't political.
It's not political. But I just
care
know,
for other people's safety.
We do, but and I just we know do. What I'm point I'm trying to get across is that it's pissing Scott Service off, and like he doesn't want to be wearing his mask the entire game either, and he wants the players to be able to. No. When you're at 85% as a team vaccinated, you're able to do more things. When you go to away games, you're able to go out and eat dinner and whatnot. And the Mariners we're not, but I was really interested to hear that when we were talking about that this weekend.
I think we all agree that's completely unacceptable that guys are missing time. You're a professional athlete and you're missing time when you could get the vaccine and completely eliminate that. I mean,
yeah. Avoid all this nonsense, man. And especially when you have like a stalwart pitcher in our bullpen, like Kendall Graveman. I mean, we just, you know, we want him to be on the team so that we can win. And not give up runs, and that's
what he does. He helps us win, and he doesn't give them up. Yeah, it's
exactly.
Ridiculous.
And him not playing on the team because of this reasoning is just, I don't know. It's frustrating to watch, and it makes you think how badly they want it. Of course, I'm sure
they want it badly. Of course, yeah, of course.
But I mean, something like this
is childish. It's stupid, and the thing is, it's so easy to make not happen, but they're choosing to flirt with dance with the devil. But in terms of other injuries, Kalu, my pick for the week, in our new game, which I don't think we still have a name for this game yet. I was trying to think of one of these last like 30 minutes, but you know, my mind just isn't anywhere.
Last 30 minutes, you had the whole week, man. This is your
idea. I was from Thursday to like 3 hours ago, I was constantly drinking beers. We had, there was like 14 of us at this bachelor party, and we had over 700 beers. There's a lot of beer. It's a lot of beer. Yeah. We bought, we did the math, and we bought over 700. But anyways, back to the point here, Kalu, he goes out and he's going to be out for a long time. Late into the year. Sounds like it's another, pretty much the same injury he had, but I think it's worsened. And so that sucks. Yusei Kikuchi last night took a one hop screamer off the inside of his kneecap on his right leg. Turns out this morning they woke up not as bad as they thought. He was walking pretty fine with it, with minimal pain. That's really good to know, because as we just get Marco back, I mean, you got to be kidding me if we lose Yusei. It's just, you know.
And Justin Dunn, too, is on the IL as well.
He'll be back his next start, it sounds like, with Justin Dunn. But, yeah, it's just like, what's up, man, with these injuries? And I know what the deal is. I do. I know. It's the Trident. It's the curse of the Trident. You know what? Poseidon is taking his Trident and he's beaming us with it, injuring us.
Let's dive a little bit deeper into K. Lou. So it's a very, very minor meniscus tear. But, the Mariners, because he's such a young and important piece to our franchise, they're probably going to be very cautious. To Kikuchi, he's probably going on the IL. He's going to miss at least one start, maybe two, because of bad contusion like that. Was it his plant leg or drive leg? Do we know that?
It was his drive leg. Hold on.
I would think that would be...
No, it was his plant leg. It was his plant leg.
Okay, I think plant leg would be a little bit harder to come back from, because a bad contusion, you're landing on that every single time you pitch. You could make the argument that if you're driving off the back leg and you had to deal with that injury, it'd be tough to get a lot of velocity on your ball.
Yeah.
But only 6 runs allowed in his last 3 outings. He was cooking. So that's a tough loss. We just can't seem to stay healthy. Evan brought it up that Dunn is also probably going to miss his next start.
Yeah.
You guys want to do a week in review? You want to look at where we are from the last podcast, 3-4.
Yeah, this past we had a full week of baseball, right? There weren't any off days.
Yep.
We have an off day tomorrow on Monday, but yeah, I mean,
you said 3-4, right?
3-4.
Yeah, that's tough. And then in hindsight, I know, just to kind of take in the Rangers series, that the Rangers, then the A's, then the Angels. I mean, divisional opponents, 14 games in a row, something like, or I don't know how many games it was, but we finished 7-4. It was 11 games against those guys.
Yeah.
That's good. But in the last week, I mean, first 2 games we lost to Oakland, which was a bummer. For us to at least come back today, split the series with the Angels. I mean, yesterday sucked, obviously, because Kikuchi going out, and then the bullpen really blew it. Fraley had a grand slam, which is great to see. Yeah. Fraley's been doing pretty decent since the few games he's been in.
He only walks or homers.
Continues to just be absurd with his eye and taking walks, which blows my mind.
Yeah, I think better than decent. As a young guy like that, I mean, he had a 40% walk rate coming into this game, and then he walked again today.
Yep.
He had that grand slam. He had another opportunity with the bases juice, and what did he do? He walked, and he gets an RBI on that. That's pretty cool to see. I thought the biggest game of the Angel series was, so we win game one. That was awesome. But then we come back game two. It's 3-2, bases loaded in the eighth inning, nobody out. And we at least struck out twice, but I think we might have struck out 3 in a row. And we lose that game 3-2. Couldn't push a run across. That's a tough one. We win that game. It's a 3-1 series, and we're looking at a 4-3 over the last 7 games. But love that we came back and won today's game, split with the Angels, and now we're on to Detroit.
I want to revert back to the Oakland A's series. Did you guys see when we went on that walk-off, Tom Murphy's reaction when he...
Oh, Tom Murphy, crazy eyes. I thought that was the week prior. It's all mixed together. Yeah, dude, that crazy eye look is insane. And like the beauty of it too is because Seager got him to do it. Like Seager called him out in the clubhouse. He's like, "Yo, Tom, your ass is too tight, man. Like, loosen up." And really? He's like, "You know what?
I didn't know that."
Yeah, he goes, "Seager, you're right." And so he's like, I'm gonna try and smile. And he was saying that back at home with his kids, he'll always do that face with them, make that crazy eye looking face, and it'll scare the hell out of him. And he's like, that's gonna be my smile for now on. And so it was perfect timing, man. I mean, he hits the walk off and you're seeing it because he's waiting to see, he sees it gets caught, and you can see him falling the ball to home plate, and seeing Ty France come around his score. And then he looks to the dugout and does a crazy face look, man. Eyes popping out of his head, veins coming out. You love to see that. And that's kind of the veteranship that Seager's going to be able to do right now. You know, his bat's slacking, but getting guys to bringing the best out of him. And Tom's having a nice little run this last week.
Yeah,
I agree. Well, I mean, I think if you had a boxing match or MMA fight, Murphy might be coming out. You guys see him, the team swarming him. And he's battling people off. He's faking people out. And like, you know, I don't know if anyone want a piece of Murphy, but I love in baseball those walk-offs. It's like it's a free ride to beat the shit out of the guy that just just came up with the big sack fly like Murphy did. But I don't know if you want a part of Tom Murphy.
You see the guys in there trying to rip his jersey off, and he's like, "Nah, you ain't getting it. You ain't getting it. No,
yeah, you're not getting it."
He's not the biggest catcher we've ever seen, but he seems scrappy.
He's strong as hell. They say that he like deadlifts an unreal amount, squats, benches. I mean, he's always in the gym. It was definitely fun to see him get rewarded. Still batting 163, but he kind of heated up himself. He is now up to 6 homers, and hopefully he can get started a little bit.
And one thing I don't want anybody to miss at all is when we're seeing Luis Torrens back behind the plate, with Logan Gilbert's outing today as a rookie, Tom Murphy was behind the plate. And as a rookie for Logan Gilbert, it's crucial for him to be able to throw the pitches, knowing and having confidence that the guy behind the plate is going to be able to block it, no matter if somebody's on the base or not. Preferably if somebody's on the base, block the damn ball. Luis Torrens couldn't do it. He was so bad at blocking anything coming his way. It was just absurd. But Tom Murphy, he didn't have a single pass ball today. And there were numerous curveballs. Logan Gilbert's curveball was nowhere today. His slider got figured out later in the game. But his curveball was nowhere. He was throwing it in the dirt, left and right. And Murphy blocked every single one of them. He guarantee you he saved a couple runs today with the way he was blocking the ball. And, I mean, that's one thing that we cannot miss is having that guy behind the plate. It's huge. It's huge. It's saving runs.
Right. Yeah. And you and I, Chris, the Mariner game that we went to earlier this week on Wednesday when we lost 6-0 to the A's, boy, that wasn't fun to watch. But you had brought something up that kind of was interesting to me. And Chris, on the last episode, you, with respect to rule changes, I mean, Chris's opinion on you know, and this is getting off topic, but Chris's opinion on like moving the strike zone down, or moving the mound back or whatnot, it's the exact same thing as like making the basketball rim higher than 10 feet, right? Like that, you know, you just don't mess with those staple characteristics of the game. But
can we get something straight? You can call me Zweifel, you can call him Soba.
Okay. Yeah.
I was getting lost by Chris's.
What about Zweifel? With the German pronunciation.
However you want to say it, man. I think that's how you actually say it.
Yeah. So Zweifel, to that point, I totally agree. I don't think that those kind of rules should be messed with. But one thing that Chris brought up that was kind of interesting while we were watching the game is, you know, if your position is called catcher, right? And you happen to drop a ball, that should arguably automatically a ball.
That should be a ball pending in as long as it's not swung at. So if there's a pitch and it's right down the middle and the catcher drops the ball and the batter did not swing, the catcher did not complete the pitch. The catcher dropped it, therefore it should be a ball. I used to think differently on that after having numerous conversations about this with numerous people. I've had my mind swayed, and it makes complete sense that if the catcher does not drop a ball that was not swung at, but it was a strike, should have been in the strike zone or whatever you want to call it, it should therefore then be a ball. You got to complete the catch.
So let me add to that, because it's like a collaborative, performance here. The pitcher has to throw, the catcher has to catch, but we almost do kind of see that. Like if there is a guy stealing and there's a ball right down the middle or close to it, definitely in the strike zone, and the catcher catches it but then throws down to second, a lot of time the ump's mind just goes blank and it's called a ball.
Yeah, like, right.
Well, that was down the middle. But, I like that point. We can get into all these different funky rules in baseball. There's definitely a lot of them.
Oh, there's a number.
there is a number, but we don't have any – well, the MLB is making these rules just to increase viewership, and quite honestly, they're not doing a good job. But
that's what we're here for now.
We're doing this on behalf of them.
But on their behalf. But yeah, I mean, other than that, what else, Wife, would you want to, you said you had some numbers to go over.
Well, the week in review, we already kind of talked about the, or maybe we didn't. Let's just go back over it. The 31st, so we are the first game with the A's, we win 6-5-10. That was the game we're talking about with Murphy where he walked it off. Mm-hmm. But Walton hits his first home run, a 3-run home run that gives us a we're down 1-0 and we're up 3-1 after he hit that. They end up taking us to extra innings, but Murphy gets it done. But a quality start by Gilbert, six innings pitched, 200 runs, 5 Ks, only 1 walk.
Is that the appropriate statistic when you say quality start? Like he met the criteria for?
Well, you have to go 6. And,
yeah, got it. Got it.
Yep. 2 runs or less, yeah.
Yep. 2 runs or less. So he had 200 runs. And then I just kind of in my notes said we're going to skip over June 1st, June 2nd because the A's blow us out 12-6, 6-0. Mm-hmm. But then Sheffield comes back in that first game with the Angels.
Yeah.
5.2 innings pitched and then 2 earned runs, but 7 Ks over 5.2 and only 3 walks. But this was the best outing by the bullpen. So we go Chargot, Seawald, Middleton, Montero, 3.1 innings pitched, 0 hits by 4 different relievers, 3 Ks and no walks. So that got us the first game. And then as we talked about in that second game, we kind of blew a big opportunity with the bases loaded. We lose the next 2 games. We know how we came back today. Good win. But I wrote down highlighted because we talked about it last week, Chargot and Seawald. And I said I wasn't on the Seawald train. Well, now I am because 12 innings pitched, 20 Ks in 12 innings, 3.0 on the dot ERA and a 1.25 whip. Chargot just doesn't throw balls. He starts off with a strike. And if he gives up a hit, sure. He's still averaging over a K per inning. So 13.1 innings pitch and 14 Ks, 0.77 whip. So we found 2 guys that we can add into our bullpen when Graveman comes back, that it's going to give us a boost. I like what Jerry has been able to do, finding these guys.
Yeah. You had mentioned an interesting stat coming into the beginning of this week. When I texted the group and I was like, hey, and anything we should keep an eye on. And Zweifel had mentioned like, here's an interesting, you know, depressing stat, but our bullpen has an ERA of like, I don't know, something out of this world. And I remember for so many consecutive weeks, we had been, you know, just praising the bullpen for not allowing anything. But it's important. And once we get like Kendall Graveman back, especially, I still am very bearish on Rafael Montero. He gets in situations that increase the blood pressure, but outside of that, like it's nice to see, arguably our strongest asset kind of start to fight its way back into direction.
They are finding their way back to the right direction, and it's just brutal with more starting pitchers getting taken out because then that means
you
have to go back to the starting games with the bullpen committee.
Yeah,
which is tough, and it's using these arms that aren't meant to. Supposedly, numbers wise, or the way we want to use them, they're not meant to be used with this often, and they're not meant to be starting games and being in so early. And then that just kind of screws you for the rest of the series or the next series, depending on when that game's played.
And I mean, I think this is a good segue to Hector Santiago, because now that we're losing pitchers left and right, and we're going to have to go back to those bullpen days, picking up a guy like Hector Santiago, who is pretty much a long reliever, he can get you 3. And where did this guy come from? Soba, you said he was on a what?
He was on a spear fishing trip a couple weeks ago. And his agent gets a call from Mr. Jerry DePoto, and Jerry's and Jerry's like, we need Hector to come pitch for the Mariners. And so Hector gets a call, and while he's on a spear fishing trip, figures he's going back to the MLB, so we pick him up. And yeah, he's been spent a lot of his time with the Angels, a lot of his time with the White Sox, been on Detroit as well. He's been everywhere, on the Mets. He's been around the league, but he's definitely a veteran. He's 33 years old. And I mean, he's looked good since we've had him. He's made his pitches. He's made his veteran pitches. He's controlling the zone as a veteran does. And he's been able to be doing all right. I know he pitched last night, and I don't think he gave up any last night. This was Saturday when we lost, but I don't think he gave up more than, I don't know how, I think it was like 1 or 2 runs. He didn't do bad, but that was just a tough game because we lost like 12.
On that second game with the Angels, he gets strapped with the loss. It's when Marco came back and they limited Marco to, 4 innings. And so Hector comes in, but he didn't do bad. Three innings. He did give up a run, but that's still a 3.0 ERA. Get strapped with the loss, but I mean, we had the bases juice, no outs, couldn't score. But I like Hector Santiago, and you know, now he's going to be used as a in those bullpen days where we come out with Duggar, and then probably in the second or third turn it over to him to eat up three innings, and then we get it to the sixth, and hopefully we can turn it over to guys like Shergo, Seawald, and I know you don't like him, Maxie, but Montero is going to be in there.
He is. As long as he's healthy, he's going to be in there. But Chris, you brought something up.
I don't blame you either.
Yeah. I don't know. No, but I don't think anybody does. It's a hell of an emotional roller coaster. But Marco Gonzalez coming back, and he was only supposed to go. The goal was three innings at 45 pitches, and he comes out, and he was at like 30-something after three, and so they let him go and finish the fourth. And for a guy coming back after being on the IL for so long, and for him to surpass the expectations that we had set, although we didn't get the win, he looks really, really good. And so we're going to take that positive out of it. I'm really excited for this upcoming series when he starts again. And we get to see him continue to climb back to his true form. But yeah, I mean, I think he did great. And then also kudos to Logan Gilbert for getting his first W tonight, Sunday. He got his first career W, and we needed those runs apparently, because in the ninth, Montero made it interesting.
No, it wasn't Montero that made
it. Oh, no, it was Keenan. It was Keenan. My bad. Yeah. Keenan Middleton. Yeah, he made it interesting. We talked
about Montero gave up a run.
When the game was 4-1, he came in, he gave up a run, and then, you know, got himself out of a jam. So good for him. But I mean, still, dude, like, I just don't feel good putting him in a bottom eight or bottom nine situation where we're ahead, we're up a run. Like, I just would never do that.
I have to retract a little bit of what I said last episode, because I don't mind Montero because I like his stuff, but I was watching it today, and he doesn't throw balls, and he tries to get ahead, so he controls the zone.
Yep.
But his pitch seems very hittable.
Yeah.
It's a two seam fastball, and then his slider is good if he can get ahead. But that two seam fastball is getting raked. I mean, I think players are hitting over 300 on it. So,
one thing I wanted to, I was scrolling through Twitter real quick, and Corey Brock tweeted out something about JP Crawford, who had a phenomenal day today. Today was the first day.
It's your boy.
Yeah. So I take home the W this week, guys, for the game. Yeah.
We'll touch on that in a minute. But today was the first day that JP Crawford's grandfather has ever seen him play in the big leagues. Nice. So his grandpa's 87 or 88 years old, lives in Pasadena, but it's been hard for him to get to a game. He's like, I'll remember this for the rest of my life. And he went off today. He had two doubles. He had a single. He scored a couple runs. Did have an error. So make sure you got that in your point book, Evan. But cool to see that. You know, always love seeing little. I'm a teddy bear, I guess, when you want to see the sentimental side of baseball. I love seeing that stuff.
Well, the one thing I've been waiting to say too, the one thing that I'm really pleased about is JP and his new, like, you know, for a while we thought Kelenic was going to be our leadoff guy, but JP has totally embraced this position. And he hit a dinger, first pitch yesterday? In the
off Shohei Ohtani, dude.
Yeah, off Ohtani. Yes.
Dang,
we love to see that. And I remember at the very beginning of the season, I just, you know, I was
skeptical,
very skeptical about JP Crawford.
Yeah, I mean, the beginning of the season, his numbers were brutal; they were rough.
Yeah, but I will say because we're assuming that he is the meditative guy.
Yes, right? We are. Yes, as Andy K told us.
Yeah, it goes to show that shit works, man.
Originally, like last week, both you guys talked about how JP should lead off, and maybe they're listening to the podcast. I don't know. That worked out well. So
I was about to pat ourselves on the back myself. We said exactly how it ended up turning out, that Crawford goes and leads off like he did last year at certain spots, and then Kelenic goes to five. I have some Kelenic notes here. Do you guys want me to?
Yeah. Let's dive into Kelenic. Yeah.
Yeah. We need to dive into Kelenic.
Do we want to though?
We have to. Kelenic is approaching the worst. You know, I'll let you take the numbers. I'm sure you may have the stat down.
Ofer is last 40. And, you know, you want young prospects to face adversity. No one here in this podcast is impatient, but you also want to avoid them getting exposed. And I think we're at that point where, man, he's slamming his bat after every strikeout. And he struck out like three times in four consecutive games, or three out of four consecutive games. For me, and I can't believe that I'm on this train, because I was so bullish on Kelenic, and I still am long term.
Yeah.
But right now, because all I want to do is have him be a superstar in the future, and I don't really care about this year because I don't think we're going to make the playoffs. But if it's best for him to get sent down and kind of do a Trammell job, because Trammell went down and just started raking, and you know, if you can do the same with Kelenic, who's a bigger prospect, I think you do it. I like what Fraley's been doing. So, you know, Fraley just kind of moves into the everyday lineup. Kelenic goes down. Let him get a, you know, 100 at bat.
I fully agree with this 100%. And I think that this should be a part of any MLB organization's developmental process. Is you, when your guy is ready, you know, so like you think he's ready for the big leagues, bring him up. And if he's struggling, it shouldn't be looked down as a bad thing for them to go back to the minors. That should just be like, okay, they got their first experience in the big leagues, and we now know what they really need to fine tune, the areas that they really need to develop on and continue working on. So let's send them back down, have them work on those things. And then once those T's are crossed and those I's are dotted, we'll bring them back up. And so that should just be something that's in the developmental organizational process of each of these young players. And it shouldn't be looked at as a bad thing. It's okay to go back down and work on what you need to work on, come back up and make sure it's fixed though.
Well, yeah. I mean, Mike Trout did the same thing. He came up and then he got sent back down. So,
oh, I didn't know that. Well, what's frustrating about this thought process is for the longest time, we were complaining about the fact that he had not yet been brought up. Right.
Well, were we complaining, or was it the fan base complaining?
I was complaining.
You were complaining. I've always, like, of course, like you want. I'm a very antsy person, I guess, in general. Like, I'm patient, then also antsy. You know, call it what you want. I don't care. Mm-hmm. But like, I'm okay with, because you know, the expectations for this year, right? They're not to make the playoffs or to continue the developmental process of these guys for next year in 2023, really. But yeah, I mean, I was never like saying, oh, he's been down there for way too long, bring him up, because I mean, what Jerry said, I believe everything Jerry says, and I don't think he was holding him back to avoid arbitration whatsoever. I don't think that was in his mind, in his mind process at all. Mm-hmm. And so Jerry's like, he had like under like 200 at bats or something like that, or wasn't 500, I forget the exact number that he needed to be for the checkpoint Jerry wanted him to be at. And fans were getting pissed off. So bring him up. He's been in the minors too long. It's like, you realize the minors didn't happen last year during COVID. There was no minors season. So we missed out on an entire developmental season. And so it's okay. Like, for this, we're still like, he's clearly not ready. Clearly not ready. So he needs to go back down, work on what he needs to work on. It's okay. Well, go back down. Send him back down.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say the other things that's frustrating to see is, like Zweifel said, it's, you know, we're just as frustrated watching him strike out and go 0 for 40. But I'm telling you, man, everyone loses their temper in baseball at some point, right? And there's a boiling point, and I get that. And especially when you have such high expectations for yourself that, you know, I get where that's coming. But, you know, you can't be slamming the bat and you can't, you know, show so much weakness and vulnerability in that sense, because not only does the opposing team say, oh, this guy's, you know, I can get in his head real quick, but
he's kind of, I know exactly what you're saying. Like, when he first started doing this, I was coming out saying like that I liked it because it was showing his passion and whatnot.
Right.
But now it's like, dude, you're striking out and not getting on base for 40 times in a row now. It's a little too much. It's a little childish now. You know, you got to pick your head up and stop getting so pissed off at yourself.
For me, it's not about the action of slamming the bat. It's if he was in between, you know, mixing in some hits and you know, slugging a little bit, and then when he did strike out, he's just that competitive that he's slamming the bat. I don't care about that. It's the fact of where he was at to. Now you're seeing it play out in his emotions and how he's reacting to failure. Where before, it was early. He didn't, he was patient enough and he has high expectations, but he was grounding out and just running to first, whatever. Now it's like, what is there something that that he feels like he can't get over, like maybe a breaking ball. He just can't hit that pitch. Right. I can't hit it. And then it's in your head and like, damn it, I can't hit it.
Yeah.
So then go down.
Yeah. Well, I also want to point out, remember we talked to Joe Doyle earlier this year and he was saying that Kelenic has had up until the MLB, he's had nothing but success. And so this is really his first time handling failure. And so now you're seeing it. And I guess like you said, he hasn't been used to it. So those emotions are coming out. So I just wanted to point that out as well.
Yeah. The biggest stretch of like no hits he had was like 10 games before this 40 game stretch. And the big league record set by Chris Davis from the Baltimore Orioles, which is, I think he got 46 games.
46 games or 46 at bats?
46 at bats.
Kelenic, it's at bats.
40. It's at bats. That's what I meant. Yeah, bats. Yeah. 46 at bats in a row, not games. And he's at 46 at bats away from that record. And as a rookie, do you want them to really go and face that record? I don't know. I doubt Scott's looking at that in his evaluation, or excuse me, Jerry, for that matter, in his evaluation of setting him back down to the minors. Maybe he is. I don't know. But if I'm thinking of myself as a big leaguer rookie and I'm Jarred Kelenic, I'm not wanting to have that record anywhere close to my name. And so that would be in the back of my mind personally.
Yeah,
he should be thinking about it. That's you don't want their first taste of the MLB, to be you're breaking Chris Davis's 0-46. Is that really the record?
Yeah, that's the record. Yeah.
46.
46. Okay. You think that's low?
I think that's low, yeah. But I mean,
that's a record.
I used to love Chris Davis. That guy could hit the
ball. He's the reason I put Redman in my lip when beer league. Oh, okay. And quick segue here, ladies and gentlemen. This last Thursday was opening day for Figurehead Brewing softball. Max and I are on that team. We are the reigning champions. We won 2 years ago, didn't have a season last year, but it felt so good to be back on the diamond covering third base. Your boy went 3-for-4, batting 750. No biggie there. In the leadoff spot, big surprise. Yeah, right. But we had a lot of fun, and beer league softball is the best thing in the entire world next to Seattle Mariners. But
Chris, God, I gotta say, man, being back. You gotta hug the line more.
I know.
Chris saw so many just hot ground, like just lasers.
They were right on the line.
Right on the line. And I counted like six, I swear to God. But I just was like, I'm out there in right field because I have an arm, but Eric Kimpton, our coach and legend,
has a
better arm, and he
extremely is much better arm.
Yeah. Well, okay. Knock it off.
His arms are phenomenal.
I don't disagree, but you can't be hating on my arm. I have a decent arm. Okay. No, I'm a little sensitive today. I apologize. But I went 1-for-3, had a laser that almost took off the pitcher's head, but that was all fine. And then I grounded out, and then I, flew out. I didn't pop out. I got some muscle behind it. we ended up losing, 16-13?
We lost by 3, yeah. We had 4 of our starters up. But anyways, this is a Seattle Mariners podcast, not a Figurehead Brewing podcast. But shout out real quick to you Seattle listeners, Figurehead Brewing in Magnolia by Chinooks. We are not sponsored by them. Our softball team is sponsored by them. The podcast is not. But it's a good beer, good local beer by Chinooks and Magnolia, Fisherman's Terminal. Definitely highly recommend. Check them out. If you go get their Patters beer, that's my favorite. And they always got this old guy there that's cooking up bread in the oven, and he's handing it out for free. And it's like really good bread with garlic and herb spices on it. It's a good environment. Sunny Saturday, get down there. You'll enjoy it. But segue then, I guess let's talk about the last thing to touch on for last week is the numbers game. Can we spitball here, boys, real quick and figure out a name for this game?
Well, what are the Padres call it?
I don't know. We're not going to take it from the Padres.
No. Right. I mean, just perhaps for some inspiration, but
just pick for the week. Monday Mojo Fantasy.
Monday Mojo Fantasy pick for the week. That's what it is. Monday.
I mean, you know, you put me on the spot here to come up with a name for a game.
Yeah, we, I like it.
Creative. Oh, I'm not feeling pretty creative, especially creative.
No, I like it. Monday Mojo's fantasy pick for the week.
A little long, but
you know, whatever. Evan went with his pick, JP Crawford. I believe he had 9 points, right, Evan?
Yeah, he had about 9 points. Are we including home runs and hits at all, or just doubles? Yeah. And we are
everything. Yeah, if it's a homer, it's 4 points.
Oh, then he's in double digits. Then I didn't count home runs in. Yeah.
Oh, Evan.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you had to come correct on this.
Yeah, point. But I was going off the group chat. It just said doubles, walks, and RBIs or whatever. So I would just go based off that.
No, it's a single. Here, the rules are a single is 1 point, doubles 2 points, triple three. Does that make sense? The homer's four. Yeah. And ribby, yeah. If you have a homer,
and then strikeouts minus one, right?
Strikeouts minus one. Yeah. Errors are minus error? One. Minus one for an error. Yeah. Let's do we'll do minus two for an error. Errors are bad.
No. I already have my number.
All right, fine. I know my number. It was one because Kyle Lewis had one hit before that was on Monday before he went out for the entire week, and now for a long, long time, the majority of the year. So my pick it got me 1 point. Zweifel had Mitch Haniger, and how did Mitchie do?
I had 6 points. He struck out a lot, so that really hurt me.
Yeah.
And maybe strikeouts could be 0.5.
Hold on. No. You just told me that I can't change the rules, so we ain't changing that.
All right. Yeah, sir. Hey Max, we were talking. We predicted that you probably would have chose Ty France, keeping that Louisiana vibe. Vive la France.
Vive la France.
We can give you Ty France, and you can get those points.
No. Allow me to officially insert myself into Monday Mojo Fantasy Pick of the Week, which is a terrible name. I was thinking about going with Jake Fraley this week.
You were not thinking about Jake Fraley. Just give him Ty France.
Do you have the numbers for Ty France?
No, I don't.
All right. Well, see, if we don't have the numbers, we can't give them because that's going to take too long for us to count up right now. So, Max, you unfortunately missed out on last week. Sorry about that. But good news is you're only in last place by 1 point. I'm in second to last place, and that's okay. That's okay. We got a long, long season, a lot of ball left to play. But Evan won. Evan, you get first pick in this week's Monday Mojo Fantasy Pick.
And I can't take the same hitter, right? It's got to be somebody different. Oh man, put me on the spot here. Okay. So Kalu's out, and then let's see. I'm gonna ride the hot train, and I'm gonna go Jake Fraley this week.
Oh,
Yeah, I think I like when he's hitting those two home runs. I think he can build off of it, and yeah, I'm going Jake Fraley.
Do walks count as anything?
Yeah, walks count as a point. Oh yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. All right, and Zweifel, you came in second, so you got next pick.
Man, do I take JP Crawford? Try to keep that going. Yes, I do.
JP Crawford for you. All right, and then Max. Well, I guess are we going Max next or me?
Well, I didn't play last week.
Let's go Max because your player got hurt.
All right, Max, you go.
Shoot, man. I really did want Jake Fraley. I think.
Well, he's gone.
I think that's going to the moon. Wait, what?
I said he's gone. Yeah.
Well, tough titties.
Yeah, tough one.
let's see. I'm looking at Taylor Trammell, and I think I'm gonna go with Taylor Trammell. Did anyone go with Seager last week?
No, nobody was.
We talked about it. He was a talking point, but
yeah. Well, you got Trammell then.
I think I'm going to regret it, but I hope I don't. Let's go, Taylor.
Final answer. All right. Vive Top France. I'm going with it. It's the obvious pick to choose. I mean, he's been somewhat consistent. I mean, we're going against Detroit first series, and we got swept by them last time. We're going to need him in big time. And I liked having him batting third today. I think that's going to work out if we keep keeping him there instead of a little bit further down as we've been having him. But yeah, Ty France is my pick, which I guess
– No one takes Haniger? Really?
No, we're not taking Hanny. not taking a handy. He was striking out a lot.
I kind of want to have a Cinderella story here. I want to pick the underdog. I'm a big underdog guy. And Taylor Trammell.
That's why we like the Mariners.
That's an understatement.
The Mariners have made me into an underdog person. So anytime I'm watching a sporting event, I'm wanting the underdog to win. It's just, you know, that's where my heart lies. But let's talk about this upcoming week. First series is obviously, like I just said, off Detroit. No game tomorrow. Monday Mojo, you know, recorded on a Sunday, dropped on a Monday. Tomorrow is Monday.
There it is.
No game. There it is. And then we start, like I said, to Detroit. We got three against them. And after Detroit, we got three against Cleveland. And so no predictions here. I'm not going to do that again. Last time we did this, actually, last time we had Detroit, I was correct because I predicted we would get swept. Try to do reverse psychology. But I got reversed on the psychology, and then we actually got swept. So that sucked. We
actually got swept. So I ain't
going to say that this time again. But Cleveland, we did well against in the first outing this year. We took 3 of 4 from them. So anything could happen this week. But big keys are going to be, you know, watching Marco. He's going to be pitching on Tuesday. And Chernobyl, who pitched a no-hitter against us, will not be playing. I think he's actually on the IL for Detroit. So there's even better news. But I'm excited to see what Marco can do. And then I think we can, if we can get, you know, obviously a 4-2 in this one, call it, that's something I'll be extremely happy with.
Is that an official prediction?
It's a hope.
Okay. One thing I wanted to highlight, I just thought it was interesting, is last year in 60 games, we were 27-33. So we just passed the 60 game point in this year, and we are we're 29-31. So we
30-31.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, but at 60 games we were 29-31.
Oh, got it.
Well, we won the first one of the next 60, so that's good. But
let's go.
Yeah, we improved by 2 games from last year over 60 games, and that's with all the injuries we've had, and we know how many injuries we've had. Paxton, Marco, bullpen going out, Kalu down
twice. Kalu down twice,
right? So, you know, always trying to look on the bright side. Always trying to look on the bright side. This isn't a playoff year, in my opinion, but we are doing some good things.
The last thing I'll say about, I think the last thing I want to say before I say anything else on this episode is, I am not yet saying that this year is not a playoff year. I think there is still room for a miracle. And quite honestly, hopefully our listeners will keep listening just to have this glimmer of hope, because we all know what that's like. But I think we're not down. We're down, but we're not out. We're 5 games back from Oakland. And I think once we get over this quote unquote injury bug, and Chris, I think this is so much more than an injury bug, but
it's a Trident curse.
Hey, you're doing it again, calling us Chris. I don't know who you're talking about.
Sorry, that's not going to come through very well over the audio. Soba. It's a little bit more than an injury bug, but bottom line is I'm excited. And you know, we've been through this adversity before as Mariner fans, and We're only going up. Anything else we can cover, boys? It's been a hell of a
One thing that is completely not Mariners related, but it's in gesture of the Oakland Athletics looking for a new home, and Portland, as we've talked about them activating or being activists for it. Netflix just released a documentary called The Battered Bastards of Baseball. And it's about the Portland Mavericks independent baseball team.
I'm going to watch that tonight.
It is one of the best documentaries. I'm a lover of baseball, so it may be a little bit biased, but anybody listening to this podcast, I'm sure, is actually a lover of baseball too. So you'll like it. But really, really cool story, about that. And just like 4 to 5 year time frame when Portland had an independent baseball team, and they dominated. They took it to the MLB's farm teams, and the MLB hated them. And it's about, you know, these guys that didn't make the league but wanted one more chance, and they had so much personality, and they just messed around on the diamond and had fun and showed what baseball really should be. And they did it by winning as well. And so really, really cool story. Check it out. But all in all, you know, another decent, we'll call it a just below average week for the Seattle Mariners, injury bugs and whatnot. But all in all, continue to going to be happy with where we're at with the adversity we've been faced.
Yep. The last thing I'll say too, and I lied. Speaking of Netflix, I added a new movie to my top movies list. It's Layer Cake.
You texted me that. I did watch that.
You need to watch that. It's on Netflix. Daniel Craig, Tom Hardy. We're talking blokes from across the pond. And we are talking drug lords and swanky, rich, high up kingpins. And it's a lot of fun. But, you know, it's raining here in Seattle on Sunday. We've gone 3-4 this week. We are hoping to do a lot better next week. Chris hopes for 4-2. We're not predicting it. Not Chris, Soba. Soba hopes for this. This is my first episode doing it with Chris Weifel, Chris Soba, Evan Barron. Evan's got a fancy...
You got to practice that.
Yeah, we do. Yeah, we do. Evan's got a fancy dinner to go to, but thanks for listening and have a great week. Go Mariners.
Go Mariners.